It's another beautiful morning, and we've got a fantastic guest in here to talk about what happened in Woolwich in the United Kingdom. It's another beautiful morning, and we've got a fantastic guest in here to talk about what happened in Woolwich in the United Kingdom. It's your friend of mine, a very good researcher from Canada. His name is Mr. C4. Go ahead there, sir. Can you give us a bit more information on what you consider actually happened in Woolwich in the United Kingdom?
Well, it's obvious by the video that I saw earlier today that this so-called assailant dropped his weapon when asked to by the authorities, in which case they decided to engage him with gunfire anyways as he was running away from them. So obviously they had a clear intent of trying to kill them. This was before they really knew what they had done, where they had done it, who they had done it to. Sounds to me like British bobbies don't intentionally go around armed, because there were many of them that were armed shooting at them. It's really curious.
Do you seriously consider, though, that this guy was some kind of radicalized Muslim that was just striking back at the war on terror? Do you seriously consider that this was, as we saw, as some kind of nutjob Muslim, one of the immigrants, that they wanted us and they wanted to paint that for us, in which they did? Do you seriously believe, as the media told us, as the story is?
Well, from what he said, and under other circumstances, he would be considered a patriot. He didn't ask people to change their religion, he asked them to change their government. And it just happened that he was a Muslim. But the main point of it is that he was trying to warn his British fellow citizens of the dangers of their own government, not of the religion that was in government, but because of the politics that was in government.
Well, there's been a lot of suggestion, especially across the headline news, that this guy actually beheaded a UK soldier outside the UK Army barracks in the middle of broad daylight in the United Kingdom in the most heavily CCTV area of London. Tell me, sir, do you buy that? Do you buy into the fact that this guy actually beheaded someone in those circumstances, and yet that there's no actual evidence for that? Do you buy that somebody was actually beheaded at all?
No, the victim wasn't beheaded. Well, I haven't seen any substantial proof that lends to the fact that they beheaded anyone as of yet. It's still pending. The curious thing is, who's saying that there was a beheading? And do they have proof? This is, you know, something that has been invented by Zionist media to give notion to the barbaric nature of the Taliban and want to associate Muslims with beheadings while they spent the better part of the Dark Ages guillotining the shit out of everyone. Right? It's ridiculous.
Well, sir, a lot of my evidence is pointing to the fingers of the Zionists. There seems to certainly be a lot of parallels between the types of attack we've seen from Mossad and this type of attack. Would you go so far as to concur with my research evaluation that this is just more of the same of the false flag attacks that we saw at Boston and we saw at Sandy Hook? Do you consider that this is more of the government just trying to infuse terror and fear amongst the people?
Not necessarily, because at this point, the government hasn't come forward with any conclusive evidence to tell anyone in any regard what was involved. All that was done was there was a report of a crime, and it's being embellished. So I don't think the government has said anything at this regard. It's going to be interesting to see what they do come up with. Their sources, their accusations, even their own culture as being defined by a news report, and that's the problem. Too much consent is generated by an entity that's there to form public opinion based on an agenda. All right, now, fuck the Brits if they think they can start a war and contain their public from a war. You know the old saying, you make your bed, you lie in it? This is how shit happens. it's war. So before you throw, you know, the first stone, expect to get a bloody nose when it's thrown back. Why should anything be condemned? They are fully engaged in hostilities. Just because it comes to visit England doesn't excuse them from anything. A war crime in London is a war crime in Iraq, is a war crime in Mogadishu, is a war crime on the dark side of the moon. Right? To me, there is no political limitations to engage. It's simple. You don't want war, then don't start one.
So, for your mind, sir, you do consider that this was an honest Muslim attack, or that this guy was in any way, shape, or form representing Islam when he did this action?
No, I'm not saying anything of the sort. I'm saying that the government has maintained a silence, and I want to hear more from the government about what it is that they can substantiate. The burden of proof is on the government, and I haven't seen any.
Well, sir, Mr. C4, you and I both know every time the onus is on the government to provide evidence and proof of what they're trying to claim, we know that that's never withstanding, that they can never do that, that they never have any substantial or solid evidence to back up anything they say, that they can never get their story straight. So it seems to be we have more of the same, where the government's tight-lipped and letting it all run in the hands of the media, trial by media. This sets a very, very dangerous precedence for the future of our democracy. Certainly, as a true Western person yourself, wouldn't you agree this sets a very dangerous precedence for our democracy?
No, democracy's been all but eradicated in the West. It has become incompatible with the corporate agenda. Democracy has been replaced by a consumer guarantee.
Well, sir, Mr. C4, can you tell me if anything has changed at all in the world since we've been waking up to the threat of Zionism in our governments? Has anything changed at all?
Lots has changed. Haven't you heard? Us Westerners are replacing Zionists with Asians because they have better credit. So, you know, it's amazing that America hasn't paved over Israel and made it into a theme park for Chinese. 1.3 billion snow cones. Can you imagine the sales? America would be out of debt in 24 hours. Call it Ho Chi Minh City, East. Israel is almost irrelevant in the world at this point. I think Israel eventually will be defunded, and every Zionist will want their new homeland, Beijing. They're all going to go over there and look like they're getting a flashlight shone in their eyes and trying their best to look Chinese so they can slip in the back door of the Politburo. I think Israel is going to be abandoned. It's just there's no money in it anymore. They've lost the Turks as allies. Europe hates them. They have no more money. Who's there to support them? And it's even funnier when you really think about it, because one of the major movements in China follow the Falun Dong religion. And do you know what the symbology behind Falun Dong is? It's a swastika. I shit you not. Imagine the Israelis telling 1 billion Chinese that they're anti-Semitic but still need their money. Oh, you can Google Falun Dong on Wikipedia. It'll show you their nice swastika. Who knew, huh? But no, the British did not hand over Palestine to the Zionists. They handed it over to one person, Rothschild. He owns Israel, and I think he's going to have a default payment soon. All right. But make no mistake about it. The person that is solely responsible for populating Israel with enough Jews to help a coup establish itself was Adolf Hitler. During the transfer agreement in 1933, he made sure the Jews had enough Jews in Palestine so that people like the Stern Gang wouldn't fail. There'd actually be enough Jews in Palestine to actually call it a state, because before that, there were no Jews, right? It's like this, 2,900 years ago or such, Xerxes turns to Leonidas and says, "What's a Jew?" And Leonidas says, Isn't that a tree fungus in Egypt or something? Do you get my point? Look, there's no scientific, archaeological, anthropological evidence to ever say that the Jews were ever an influential culture in anything, or a steadfast majority. Okay. I think the Christians should start saying that the chosen land is actually Jupiter. It only stands fitting, right? Jupiter, get it? Space shuttle leaves in 5 minutes for the Holy Land. That's even funnier how a bunch of Ashkenazi atheists think they need to live in the crossroads of religion to be an atheist. Knowing full well they come from the wrong side of the Iron Curtain. Just what we need, a bunch of non-God-believing communists living under a Western funding system. I'm surprised they haven't brought the Hindus into this. Fighting a war for the government. They're not fighting a war for their West. They're fighting a fight so they can get a life. And they don't care who they have to steal, kill, or lie to. Right? Remember, when you have moral wars, people sign up without any motivation, but it seems that everyone has to be met with these big sign-up bonuses. Alright. Now, I say if the British cared so much about their soldiers, they wouldn't send them into these bogus wars. And it is a bogus war, there is no doubt about that at this point. So really, the way I see it is the ultimate form of being a traitor is to actually send your armed forces in way of harm without a legitimate remnant.
Well, sir, government chicanery and false flag attacks, non-specifically. Well, we were just discussing some of the problems that we're facing today, like Agenda 21. We're discussing some of the issues, like the emergence of the police state in all of the Western governments that we have. And of course, we all know that all of these are, in fact, ruled and controlled by the Zionists themselves, that every single one of these governments are just puppet governments to the Zionist will and the Zionist agenda. Most of the Zionist agenda is basically to kill us off, is to water down our genes, is to destroy our genes, is to break down the human DNA until there's not much left of the human at all. So we can be a subspecies just to serve them as goy cattle would be grazing upon the field. It's certainly a very, very scary prospect, but this is what they have. This is their idea. This is what is now being installed in all of the governments that we see around the world.
Well, you know, I'm not very conspiratorial, but a lot of the facts that I have found are dismissed as conspiratorial because the conspirators don't want to be exposed, so fuck them to the nth degree. If they don't like what I have to say, then maybe they'll feel more inclined to join the Communist Party in China. But this here is the West, and we have our Western ideals, and if they can't live within the confines of our philosophy governing our civilization, then they can get the hell out. And if they don't like it, we'll drive them out. There's no two ways about it. The Zionist issue is a very big influence on a lot of what's gone wrong with international policies. There's no doubt about it. What they want to do to the West is what they did to the Bolsheviks. They want to basically strip them of their own identity and replace them with a synthesized identity, which is more in line with their agenda. Well, it won't work with me, because I know who I am, I know what I stand for, and that is basically the countermeasure to their agenda, and they simply cannot argue with anything I say.